Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship, and it's good to see you. A couple of notes this morning. First, take a look at page 3 of your bulletin and go almost to the bottom, and you see the bold, "We praise." There's a P there. It's bold. It should be a C, so you go ahead and read, please. Next Sunday, after worship, we will have Family Movie Day. And I've heard that it's going to be Top Gun Maverick. Is that right? Yeah. A lot of that. So she's crossing her fingers. Sounds like a definite maybe. So we're going to see that fun movie next Sunday. And finally, Tim, stand up, face the congregation, open your shirt. Congratulations on Tim's retirement. 45 years at the school district. So, good to have you, Tim. And glad you get to wear that fun shirt. And I think that's all I need to highlight this morning. So please stand for the Thanksgiving for Baptism. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the fountain of living water, the rock who gave us birth, our light and our salvation.
Amen.
Joined to Christ in the waters of baptism, we are clothed with God's mercy and forgiveness. Let us give thanks for the gift of baptism. We give you thanks, O God. Through the waters of the flood, you delivered Noah and his family. Through the sea, you led your people Israel from slavery into freedom. At the river, your son was baptized by John and anointed with the Holy Spirit. By water and your word, you claim us as daughters and sons, making us heirs of your promise and servants of all.
Thank you.
our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Jesus, you proclaimed him your beloved Son and anointed him with the Holy Spirit. Make all who are baptized into Christ faithful to their calling to be your daughters and sons, and empower us all with your Spirit through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. A reading from Isaiah. Here is my servant whom I uphold, my chosen, in whom my soul delights. I have put my spirit upon him. He will bring forth justice to the nations. He will not cry or lift up his voice or make it heard in the street. A bruised reed he will not break, and a dimly burning wick he will not quench. He will faithfully bring forth justice. He will not grow faint or be crushed until he has established justice in the earth, and the coastlands wait for his teaching. Thus says God the Lord, who created the heavens and stretched them out, who spread out the earth and what comes from it, who gives breath to the people upon it and spirit to those who walk in it. I am the Lord. I have called you in righteousness. I have taken you by the hand and kept you. I have given you as a covenant to the people, a light to the nations, to open the eyes that are blind, to bring out the prisoners from the dungeon, from the prisons, those who sit in darkness. I am the Lord, that is my name. My glory I will give to no other, nor my praise to idols. See, the former things have come to pass, and new things I now declare. Before they spring forth, I tell you of them, the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm is read responsively. Ascribe to the Lord, you gods, ascribe to the Lord glory and strength.
Ascribe to the Lord the glory in God's name. Worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness.
The voice of the Lord is upon the waters. The God of glory thunders. The Lord is upon the mighty waters.
The voice of the Lord is a powerful voice. The voice of the Lord is the voice of splendor.
The voice of the Lord breaks the cedar trees. The Lord breaks the cedars of Lebanon.
And the Lord makes the Lebanon to skip like a calf, and the mountain like a mountain.
The voice of the Lord burst forth in lightning flashes.
The voice of the Lord shakes the wilderness.
The voice of the Lord makes the oak trees writhe and strips the forest bare. And in the temple of the Lord, all are crying, glory.
The Lord sits enthroned above the flood. The Lord sits enthroned in his kingdom forevermore.
O Lord, give strength to your people. Give them, O Lord, the blessings of peace. A reading from Acts. Peter began to speak to Cornelius and his household. I truly understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him, as does what is right, is acceptable to him. You know the message he sent to the people of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ. He is Lord of all. That message spread throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee, after the baptism that John announced. How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power. How he went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. We are witnesses to all that he did, both in Judea and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree, but God raised him on the third day and allowed him to appear, not to all the people, but to us who were chosen by God as witnesses and who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one ordained by God as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Then Jesus came from Galilee to John at the Jordan to be baptized by him. John would have prevented him, saying, "I need to be baptized by you, and do you come to me?" But Jesus answered him, "Let it be so now, for it is proper for us in this way to fulfill all righteousness." Then he consented. And when Jesus had been baptized, just as he came up from the water, suddenly the heavens were opened to him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and alighting on him. And a voice from heaven said, "This is my Son, the Beloved, with whom I am well pleased." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Grace and peace to you from God our Creator and our Lord and Savior Jesus the Christ. Amen. For you, little child, Jesus Christ has come. He has fought, he has suffered. For you, he entered the shadow of Gethsemane and the horror of Calvary. For you he uttered the cry, "It is finished." For you he rose from the dead and ascended into heaven, and there he intercedes. For you, little child, even though you do not now know it. But in this way the word of the gospel becomes true. We love him because he first loved us. That is an old French Thanksgiving prayer for the sacrament of holy baptism. While those weren't the exact words said at our baptism, this centuries-old French prayer holds the sentiment of every baptism. For you. Remember those words. For you. The festival of the Epiphany of our Lord was just 3 days ago. On that day, we hear the story of the three wise ones coming from afar to greet the new king, God's appearing to the nations in the baby Jesus. And today, Jesus begins his public ministry in his baptism by John at the Jordan River. Just as he came up from the water, suddenly the heavens were opened to him, And he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and alighting on him. And a voice from heaven said, "This is my Son, the Beloved, with whom I am well pleased." This is the same voice that we hear in the first chapter of Genesis. God said, "Let there be light." God said, "Let us make humankind in our image, according to our likeness." It is the same God of which the psalmist speaks. The voice of the Lord is a powerful voice. It is a voice of splendor and more. This is the voice for you. Recall what Luther taught us in the Small Catechism when he asks, "What is baptism?" Baptism is not simply plain water. Instead, it is water used according to God's command and connected with God's word. A little bit of Confirmation Catechism review for us this morning. What gifts does baptism grant? It brings about forgiveness of sins, redeems from death and the devil, and gives eternal salvation to all who believe, as the words and promise of God declare. In other words, in baptism, God seals us by the Holy Spirit and marks us with the cross of Christ forever. So we have the basics of Luther's teaching on baptism in the Small Catechism. He also understands baptism as an intimate encounter with God. At the center is the core Lutheran principle of justification by grace through faith. He goes on to tell us that we need to remember daily that we are baptized. So the question may come to us, if baptism is once for all, which you all learned and know, why do we need to remember it every day? Because we are at the same time saint and sinner. We are saints. You are saints. You have been bound to Christ in baptism. We are sinners. We still live in an imperfect world. We still mess up sometimes. When we die, our baptism will be complete. We will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. So how do we daily remember our baptism? Now, it may sound silly, or perhaps weird, but still it's a good way to remember our baptism. Every time you shower or bathe, make the sign of the cross and remember that you belong to Christ, and that you are loved deeply by God. Some other ways of remembering that may be less weird for us include confession and absolution, scripture reading, worshiping regularly as you do, daily prayer, and professing the creed. We give thanks and remind ourselves daily so that we never forget. How deep is this love that God has for us, that our lives have meaning because we belong to God, the Creator, the God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Baptism is one of God's gifts of grace freely given, along with Holy Communion. Luther also taught that confession is a sacrament. Even though today, and probably for most of you, most confirmands learn that there are two sacraments in the Lutheran Church, baptism and Holy Communion. In his response to the question, what then is the significance of such a baptism with water? See, we're still done with steam. Luther responds, it signifies that the old person in us, with all sins and evil, desires to be drowned and die through daily sorrow for sin and through repentance. And on the other hand, that daily a new person is to come forth and rise up to live before God in righteousness and purity forever. Where is this written? St. Paul says in Romans 6, we were buried with Christ through baptism into death, so that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, so we too might walk in newness of life. So at this point, I invite you to open your hymnals to page 243 to 244 and take a look with me. I'm giving you a minute to get there. That's the small numbers at the bottom of the page in the front of the hymnal, which I'm sure you all know. 243. So, individual confession and forgiveness. It's been my experience that many faithful Lutherans are unaware of this liturgy and opportunity for individual confession. See, in the small catechism, Luther goes on to ask, how are people to be taught to confess? And as always, again, Luther starts with a question. What is confession? Confession consists of two parts. One is that we confess our sins. The other is that we receive the absolution, that is, forgiveness, from the pastor as from God himself, and by no means doubt, but firmly believe that our sins are thereby forgiven before God in heaven. Now, generally, we confess and hear forgiveness most Sundays, not on white Sundays when I preside. But it's not required every Sunday. But this individual confession is an opportunity. Sometimes we may feel the need to say directly to another person how we've messed up and hear individually the forgiveness of sins, that the slate is wiped clean. In our baptism, or our affirmation of it, we are asked if we renounce the devil and all the forces that defy God, the powers of this world that rebel against God, and the ways of sin that draw us from God. And we respond, I renounce them. So liturgically, confession and profession of faith comes before baptism. But theologically, we understand that God has called us to God's self, as Luther states in his explanation of the third article of the Creed. I believe that by my own understanding or strength, I cannot believe in Jesus Christ my Lord or come to him, but instead the Holy Spirit has called me through the gospel, enlightened me with his gifts, made me holy, and kept me in the true faith, just as he calls, gathers, enlightens, and makes holy the whole Christian church on earth, and keeps it with Jesus Christ in the one common true faith. Daily, in this Christian church, the Holy Spirit abundantly forgives all sins, mine and those of all believers, yours and those of all believers. On the last day, the Holy Spirit will raise me and all the dead and will give to me and all believers in Christ eternal life. This is most certainly true. This is for you. And so we proclaim, blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the fountain of living water, the rock who gave us birth, our light, and our salvation. For you, little child. For you, June. For you, Tom. For you, Courtney. For you, Dick. For you, now please say your name. For you, little child. Jesus Christ has come. He has fought, he has suffered. For you, he entered the shadow of Gethsemane and the horror of Calvary. For you, he uttered the cry, "It is finished." For you, he rose from the dead and ascended into heaven, and there he intercedes. For you, little child, even though you do not know it. But in this way, the word of the gospel becomes true. We love him because he first loved us. Amen.
Amen.
all together to follow Jesus, we pray for the church, the world, and all in need. Calling God, you speak with power to your church. Open our hearts and minds to the new things you are declaring. Strengthen bishops, pastors, deacons, lay leaders, and teachers of the faith. Equip the baptized for your reconciling and redeeming work. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Renewing God, you provide the waters of the earth, and in Jesus' baptism you reveal the waters of life. Cleanse and protect oceans, rivers, and watersheds. Bring relief to parched lands and to communities without access to safe water. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Righteous God, you never weary of establishing justice. Increase cooperation and constructive dialogue between nations. Guide local, national, and international authorities to govern with equity, vision, and integrity. We pray for those in military service, for peacemakers, and our enemies. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Abiding God, your mercy is steadfast. Give sanctuary to people who flee from oppression, war, poverty, and famine. Sustain healthcare workers, caregivers, first responders, counselors, and all who help and heal. Comfort those who are grieving or experiencing crisis, especially those we name in our hearts or out loud. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Blessing God, in Christ you gather the beloved community. Kindle the gift of your Spirit in your people. Accompany the newly baptized, those recently ordained, and any beginning a new ministry. Inspire synodical leaders and congregational councils to serve with imagination and wisdom. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Peacemaking God, we continue to pray for the people of Ukraine and that Russia would retreat and honor the Ukrainians. Merciful God, promising God, your faithfulness endures throughout all generations. We give thanks for those who have died in Christ, trusting that we will be united with them and all the saints in Christ's resurrection life. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
We bring to you our needs and hopes, O God, trusting your wisdom and power, revealed in Christ crucified. The peace of Christ be with you always. Thank you. Remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours. Now and forever. Amen. The God who faithfully brings forth justice and breaks the oppressor's rod, bless, strengthen, and uphold you today and always.
Thank you. Go in peace, follow the way of Jesus.
Thanks be to God.